Upgrade.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back yet again for another movie review. This is for Oppenheimer. This is straight from Christopher Nolan. This is based on the World War II, J. Robert Oppenheimer and his work on the Top Secret Manhattan Project of the atom bomb. And we're going to go and dissect this. This officially released out July the 21st. But we have a story to tell as to why we are just now reviewing it. What up, Lucas?
Hey, look, we had to review another movie tonight, and I literally said, sir, we have not reviewed Oppenheimer yet, which, for you all wondering why we have not reviewed this film yet, we saw this film the day before we went to Comic-Con. So we literally watched this film, slept, and got on a plane that morning to go to San Diego, which led to so much more content. And this one always fell on the back burner. But we're here now to bring you our honest takes on Christopher Nolan's latest epic that has, because of the Barbie film, blown up to epic proportions.
Yeah, I was going to ask your take on that before you get into that. So do you think that Barbie kicking push off this film push this movie along, or did they push each other along based on the
no they didn't push each other along? Barbie has been dragging this movie along for weeks now. Like, in all honesty, it got sold by Universal as counter programming to Barbie, because everyone understood just how big Barbie would be, and they attached themselves to it down to the Auburn Barbieheimer shirts and all this other stuff. They did a great job of marketing and attached themselves to this film. So they made it to the extent that the moment you heard Barbie, you thought of Oppenheimer.
Right.
It's a smart move. From a marketing standpoint, it's an extremely smart move to attach yourself to what could have been the biggest, which is currently going to possibly be the biggest film of the year. Like, it's a smart move to do, and they did it brilliantly to attach themselves to that. So, no. Did this push Barbie? Not at all. Because Barbie audience could care less about this movie.
Yeah.
But because Barbie's audience normally has a mate or a companion that's maybe of the opposite sex or the opposite thought pattern, Oppenheimer became the movie to see instead.
Yeah, because it brought awareness to, like, oh, okay, the Nolan film is out. I know Nolan. Okay, cool. Yeah. Let me see if I can
exactly
check this. It was just so weird, because I was like, Universal is benefiting and Warner Brothers is benefiting, which is so fascinating how it worked out. I was curious your perspective. Yeah. But let's go ahead and get into it. The movie. I think we have not officially talked about it at all.
No. We left the screening, and I don't even think we didn't even do a reaction after watching this movie, did we?
I don't remember if we did.
I don't remember. I think we saw it and we were just like, yep, we'll talk about it later. Did never talk about it. So yeah. No, neither one of our perspectives is known about this movie.
Yeah. So I guess I'll go first. So for me, my short take on Oppenheimer, I think that from a performance standpoint, I think Cillian Murphy did an amazing job. There was a couple really good performances for me. I mean, between Robert Downey Jr., I actually thought that, and I'll talk about it a little bit later on about Josh Hartnett, whether his vocal range, like, he just did not come across as Josh Hartnett. The going back and forth between black and white and transitioning between time, and just some of the visual cues for the genius being manifested in a destructive way, as far as Robert's perspective on what his calling was. I thought that was very fascinating how Nolan was able to showcase that. But I do have some gripes about certain things, but I mean, yeah, it also is 3 hours long. So yeah, there's my short pitch thoughts. And I'll let you kind of go give yours.
My first thoughts of Oppenheimer was wrong time of year. This is should be considered an Oscar bait type of film. And you decided to release it at this time of year because of box office. At 3 hours long, this movie drags extremely long. It's not necessarily entertaining. I was not entertained by this movie. I was informed by this movie, and I understood the execution behind the movie, but the movie lost me about halfway through it when I realized, oh, this is not necessarily a movie that I will ever watch again.
Right.
And that's highly important to me. It's not the point that it's a drama, which this is. It's not a point that it's a historical drama, which it is. I've seen plenty of them, and I watch plenty of them on multiple occasions. But at no point in time that I watch or see anything in this film that made me think I need to see it again to understand the execution behind it. I thought the big moment that everyone talked about and that Nolan talked about in length was a dud. It's a film that I understand the execution behind it is really good. I understand the performances is really good, especially Robert Downey Jr.'s performance in this movie. I thought was amazing, but it's also a film that I can openly admit I don't believe is necessarily the best film, and it definitely isn't the best film as a summer release.
Wow. All right, so let's go ahead and dig in. It's late. We are not spending 3 hours talking about Oppenheimer.
Not at all. Not even a little bit.
So let's go ahead and kind of talk on, you know, the technical side real quick. The camera work, which can't, you know, Christopher Nolan is always going to go big when he's trying to use IMAX cameras for everything. Yes. The scope and feel, I don't think we officially saw it in IMAX. Did we see it in IMAX? We saw it in regular. Can't remember.
No, we saw it in IMAX. It was in IMAX.
Okay, yeah. So when we saw it in IMAX, I do know as far as sound design, like it was weird to me because the sound at times felt like it didn't go as grand as I've heard him go before, specifically when it comes to like the explosion. With the buildup for the actual explosion and the execution of the explosion, didn't work as well as when there were times when Robert was going through his mind and shifting different things. Like I felt like they used sound so much better there, and then they transitioned and did something really weird with the big payoff. And I mean, I don't know if that was a creative choice or not, but I do think that the camera work was done really well. Like there was some really beautiful shots that, you know, normally it would be like some action going on or something sci-fi going on. Like, no, there was some really great point for point shots to allow really good convincing performances. The courtroom scenes allow Robert Downey Jr. to pull off some very tough scenes that normally would kind of get like looked over, and they shot it perfectly, and he pivoted to it as well. And it was also interesting, I think Ludwig did the score for this one, as opposed to
normally
you would go with your boy and
ear bussing Hans Zimmer is what I call him.
And I think that Ludwig did a great job. I think that he left a really good impression for me, that it wasn't like too overlong, but at the same exact time it was like rhythmically, I was like, it's fit the mold of whatever Chris is trying to do with that. What do you think about, like, I guess any comments as far as the visuals or sound or soundtrack?
Not to sound what at this point, because we're reviewing it so late, would be considered controversial to some people. Christopher Nolan is the most overrated director in Hollywood right now. You can't give me basic shots and then expect me to say, oh my God, this is amazing and fantastic. No. What I give credit for is that the performances are so good, it elevates his very basic work. And that's what I felt when I was watching this film. Like, the work is extremely basic, but the performances are so good that it elevates his basic work that he's giving you in this film. So I was not impressed at all with any shots, anything set up in this film. I thought it was extremely basic. The score felt misplaced from the actual film. You gave me a score that felt more like I was watching a thriller. At the same time, I'm watching this very, very historical drama. And I felt that the score was just so misplaced. But while it fit exactly what I would expect from Christopher Nolan, it didn't fit the story that I was watching.
Yeah, I can see that.
And because of that disconnect, I could never fully get into it. And this could come from, possibly, me knowing way more about Oppenheimer's actual story than what this film portrays him as. That it completely, like, I detached within the first 45 to 50 minutes of this film when I've realized, okay, so this is the angle that you're going to play here. But then I started looking at the technical aspects of the film and I was like, oh, this is not remotely close to Christopher Nolan's best work. This is closer to the bottom rung for me of Christopher Nolan's work. And that's what I mean by overrated, because nothing was fantastic here. I was not moved by a shot. I was not moved by camera movement. I wasn't moved by anything. I was stuck by the time we got to the end of this film of thinking, oh, this is an average piece of work from a director who's supposed to be great.
All right, let's go ahead and transition into the performances and acting. So one thing I'll say, and I'll preface it like this, I felt like they did Florence Pugh dirty because there were several scenes with her that I felt like it was overly artistic for no reason at all.
Yes.
Like, I feel like they could have done these risque scenes with her and it didn't have to have her looking the way
topless.
It just was kind of unnecessary. Like, there was a specific scene with Emily Blunt, and she was kind of racing within her head, like, what's going on with my husband? What's happening? And I'm sitting there seeing this, and I'm like, this could have been such a great scene for Florence and her, but they just sit there and just threw it away for showing something as eye candy. And I was thrown off by that. But anyway, I just want to say that because I don't want to discredit anybody else. This is a huge cast, like very big cast. I can't believe how many people they put in this. Just ridiculous, to be honest. But I got to give credit where credit's due with Robert Downey Jr., man. Robert Downey Jr. in this, I mean, he did so well in it that I was thrown off. And I mean, I remember seeing the preview and I was like, is that Robert Downey Jr.? He's kind of looking unrecognizable. He plays this up so well. He plays the innocent card. He plays the strong card. He plays the supportive strength friend. He plays such a versatile character that you don't really know. You're seeing him unfold as the movie is progressing, even more so than Oppenheimer. And he's in less amount of time than Cillian Murphy is. His performance is, to me, if any other performance in this should get a nomination, his should.
Yeah.
The other one that I want to give credit for is Josh Hartnett. Josh Hartnett, I don't know what was his voice. I don't know whether how he cared. He just kind of came off as this plain scientist that just loved everything. And he normally, that's not how he talks. That's not how he plays. Like, he carried himself in a way that he felt unrecognizable. And I don't know if he took time to build that character out. I don't know if Christopher coached him in it, but I thought that he was a unwatched character. Like, people should really look at him like, okay, you did a really good job with that. I mean, again, I do give credit to Florence. I think she's an amazing actress. I think Emily Blunt's a great actress. I just think that they could have been better serviced here than what they did. But I give Matt Damon credit too. I mean, I think he has some really good notable scenes, but I've seen him be better. But did you have any standout performances from any of the cast?
I brought it up earlier, which is Robert Downey Jr., who is amazing in this film. Josh Hartnett, transformation in this film is what makes it great. He's really good in this film. I believe that those two performances really catapult this film to a place where I fully understand why people love it. Because both of them are great performances. Yeah. This is the best Robert Downey Jr. has been since The Zodiac.
Yeah.
Like, he's phenomenal in this movie. For anyone who's forgotten just how great of an actor he is, you see this movie and you immediately remember just how great of an actor he is. And that's highly important for this movie. Cillian Murphy is okay as Oppenheimer. I think he could have been better. I think he possibly was miscast. But he is okay as Oppenheimer, but he's so overshadowed by this huge cast in this film. Because I believe Robert, not only Robert, but I also believe Josh, I also believe Matt did a better job than him in this film. He just happens to be the lead character in this film, but it always felt like, even though this is a story about Oppenheimer, it's not enough of him to push the movie forward. And then there's the women in this movie. And for anyone who's not seen a Christopher Nolan movie outside of Memento, Christopher Nolan does not care about white women. He does not do them good in any movie. I don't care what movie you name. Women characters in Christopher Nolan never do good. He completely ruined everything. Every woman character in the Batman universe, he ruined every. He ruined Scarlett Johansson in The Prestige. He ruined Hilary Swank in Insomnia. Like, I don't know what it is with Christopher Nolan.
Dang,
again, outside.
Y'all about that.
Outside of Carrie Ann and Memento, I don't know what it is with him and women characters, but he does not do good with them. Elliot Page before the transition, and what was done with them for Inception was not good. He just does not write good women characters. And in this movie, to turn Miss Pugh into just a piece of meat, because that's what it felt like watching this movie. She was literally just a piece of meat. Because when you attempt to justify and say that certain scenes with her included was highly important to the story, and you see the movie, you'd be like, no, it's not. There's literally no need for her to be in some of these positions in this film.
I know.
And it felt like you only did it for shock value. I think that's where, as someone who loves film and you're watching it and you're like, dude, how do you ruin having her and Emily Blunt in a film and not understand the caliber of actress that you have here?
Right.
You threw me off there. But Robert Downey Jr. and Josh Hartnett are amazing in this movie.
Yeah.
They carry this movie. Everyone else is a supporting character in this movie, especially Robert. Robert completely carries this movie.
Yeah.
Like, and it's not called the Senator Who Oppenheimer Screwed Over movie. It's called Oppenheimer. Like, Cillian Murphy, as much as I love him as an actor, this film signified one thing to me. He is not someone who's meant to lead a film like this. And not that he cannot lead a film, because he has done amazing in other movies. But I don't know what it is about this film. I don't know what it is about Oppenheimer not being as historical truthful as it should be. Because I know the story of Oppenheimer. And the point that you went down, the angle that you did go down, I think that's what muted Mr. Murphy's performance in this film, because if you would have fully told the story of him, I think he would have killed this role. But instead, you chose to go down the possible blockbuster drama type route. And in turn, I think you stole from people who know this story what could have been a great performance.
Man. I'm just going to put up here Albert Einstein's face. But shout out to Tom. Tom did a good job in the small amount of scenes they put him as Albert Einstein. I mean, do you think somebody like maybe like Bradley Cooper would have worked better for something like
anybody,
this?
Anybody could have worked better with a better script. I don't think it's just Killian. I think it's the script that's the issue.
Yeah.
Come on, dude. You were so focused on making it seem like Oppenheimer was smarter than Albert Einstein that I think you sacrificed so much other plot points and elements to this actual story.
Yeah, I do think that the fact that Florence's nudes pushed this to a rated R film also didn't do the movie any justice from even a box office standpoint. Because it is the only thing that pushes this over to a rated R rating. Nothing else in this. Because the explosion, without spoiling the movie, doesn't show any kind of ramification. I can't say it.
Nothing.
There's
No. Here's the weird part. Yeah. Here's the weird part. The movie's been out for a month now. We can literally say it. That weak ass explosion that you all talked about and told us that was the reason why this was $100 million budget. Are you kidding me? That's the reason why? For close-up sparkles of fire? Like, when we saw this film and it got to that point, I said, oh, this is the most disappointing thing I've ever seen. Like, Oppenheimer created a bomb that was dropped on a country and you don't show that portion of it. That was the most important part of having an atom bomb. Yeah. They dropped it twice on one country. Why wasn't that shown?
Yeah, they used exposition to
which
make us identify.
We don't care when you use exposition. We don't care. Okay? Show the ramifications of one's actions, and then that can make you care more. Exposition does not make you care more.
Yeah,
it doesn't. And for anyone, including the director of the film, to come out and say, but that wasn't the point of the film. We wanted to talk about Oppenheimer. Then why even show any form of a bomb exploding? Just have a movie about him and his actions and what led to the creation of the bomb and cut it off there. But instead, you chose to show more. You chose to show a Senate hearing that had to do with dropping a bomb that you didn't show drop.
Yeah.
Come on. Like,
And I guess again, that was because he didn't want to use CG. Is that what the ruling was?
If it's because he didn't want to use CG, then somebody should have told him not to make The Dark Knight Rises, because clearly you like CG. So don't tell me that. Don't make Inception. Clearly you have no issue using CG. You made Inception with space bookcases. You have no issue using CG. Mm-hmm. Don't tell me that. That don't fly here.
Yeah.
That don't fly here.
Interstellar is not real, you guys. It does have CG.
Yeah. That does not fly here. So don't tell me that. Tell me that you didn't want to show it because that's not part of the story you wanted to tell. I'll go along with it, but then I'll ask questions afterwards.
Yeah.
But again, these are questions that people who will forgive every flaw in Christopher Nolan's work will never ask questions about. I'm going to ask those questions.
So, okay, you already identified that the story from your perspective is flawed. I do agree with that. They overly dramatify some of the aspects of what this is chosen to be about. Because the approach in the initial beginning of the movie, I was like, oh, okay, this man's psychologically imbalanced. Cool. Like, this is the ramifications of why this man is going down this road. Okay, this is where we're going. Like, he's immediately, in the very first part, is willing to kill. You know, like, he's Vlad, and he's trying to do this or that. And then it turns to him having this trifecta relationship to him being focused on his work. And it goes to three of four different plot points. And unfortunately, because it does that, I don't care about any of them. And then I'm just waiting for the creation of the bomb, who he's going to add in. That starts to be the thing that entices me. The more what happens at a certain point, because they immediately go to all these different thread points of the character, which is supposed to be a person. They pivot to everybody surrounding him, and they put more emphasis on everybody's function and everybody's character, which that's the only thing keeping me invested through the whole 3 hours, which that's the flaw because I don't get cemented or gripped to him at all. Even his relationship with his wife and the one relationship that I was very curious about, every 5 seconds I'm looking at it, I'm getting flashed. So it's kind of unfortunate that is the real disconnect. And I think that is where everything kind of spirals. And I do think that Chilean actually, I think he does a really good performance in this. I just don't think that I feel any of it. Like every other person surrounding him, I care more about. And the unfortunate thing about the story as well, and I think Lucas said it, I don't know when I'll watch Oppenheimer again, personally. Some of you guys, if you guys want to see it and support it, I fully support you. But I cannot go back and watch this again. But there are other Christopher Nolan movies I can't go back and watch. I can't go back and watch Interstellar again. I feel like I don't have the time or the patience to watch Interstellar again. I tried to watch Tenet again, and I didn't
get one should do that to themselves. No one.
I didn't get all the way through it. There are only certain movies I would go rewatch for them. Memento. I'd rewatch Inception because things I miss. I've rewatched, of course, The Dark Knight more times than any other movie I know. Batman Begins, of course. I've even watched Insomnia several different times. But anything outside of that, I don't willingly go back and rewatch again because this is a 3-hour movie. It's rated R, and there's not enough payoff to submit me to want to go and push that. That invest. So I don't have anything further, Lucas. What do you want to rate this thing?
Oppenheimer by Christopher Nolan. I don't believe this is an entertaining film. While I believe that it is a film packed with solid performances, almost award-winning performances, especially by Robert Downey Jr. and Josh Hartnett. I believe that Christopher Nolan does not know how to write a woman character. I also believe Christopher Nolan actually does not fully grasp the impact of Oppenheimer as a person in this film. I think he took him out of his element of understanding just how evil this man is, because it is evil for people that don't know. Instead, he decided to make a film that is more compact, not necessarily in length, but in story, to the general public to make you all see it better. I believe that this is a film that, boy, did they benefit off of marketing and having this movie released the same date as Barbie. Because if you release this movie at any other time of year, this movie does not do anything. It's Tenet. If you release it in October, which actually should have been released, because that is closer to the way this film plays. Is this an award contender more than anything else? But for me, Oppenheimer is a C minus to D movie. Again, I am not there's no element of direction here that I'm impressed by. I felt that the direction of this movie was absolutely average at best. I believe the performances is what elevate this movie. Yeah. Robert Downey Jr. can almost bring this movie to what I would consider a B movie. His performance is that great. Josh Hartnett is that great. If their director understood that women are important and that women characters are important, the movie could have been better. But instead, I'm stuck with a movie for 3 hours that felt that it wanted to give you a score of a thriller while giving you a drama that has no action in it. And the most disappointing setup in one of the most disappointing setups in history of film with the explosion.
It's so sad. The number, the letter that I had in mind was actually C minus.
I see. Right on the same ballpark.
It's weird. Because I kept on thinking, I think we may have, one thing I may have said to Lucas is that I think Christopher Nolan should have asked Michael Bay for help with the explosion. I think that Michael would have rocked the soft.
Yeah, 1,000%.
And I think that, I mean, he could have gotten, like, maybe it might have been approvals to go and actually show, like, you know, his Hiroshima's dropping, and maybe he had to get approvals for what that would look like. But I think that it would have
Or just better. Recreate it. Yeah. No, we are at a time frame where we have the money, we have the technology to create that explosion. Make it look amazing.
Yeah, I think that was a big underwhelming fact. And I think I agree with Lucas is that this man, in the very opening of it, I was like, okay, no, he's off. Like, he's not a good person. And they tried to play him that he wasn't. Like, he was just flawed and, you know, I don't say he's the victim, but that's almost basically how they played him. And that threw me off. I do think it maybe could be a C. I may leave it at a C instead of a C-, but ironically, before Lucas even opened his mouth, I was like, C-. But I will say this. If it is a C- for me, it is fresh. It's fresh. It's not...
Mate, hey, look. Hey, it is not fresh for me. So if it's fresh for you, that's perfectly fine.
There was something I was gonna say. And it's, box office. I heard that the end of August is when it releases in China. Do you think that would be enough to get it to
No. Is that 600 and something? It's not getting nowhere near $1 billion. Stop playing with yourself. For anyone who thinks that, you're lying to yourself, and you're lying to yourself purposely. So no.
So what do you think China's going to pull out for this movie then?
Little to nothing.
Really?
You bombed an Asian country. It may be Japan, and it may not be China. If you think they're going to just come out and show out for Oppenheimer, you've lost your damn.
Which is might be why he didn't show it. Maybe exactly. He was like, this will be the best way for us to. I don't know, but it's so weird because he shouldn't have shown Florence Pugh then. Anyway, I don't know. I think I lost Lucas. We're gonna go. Hopefully you guys enjoyed our review on Oppenheimer. Make sure you like, subscribe, hit the bell button. We appreciate you guys so much for watching. Go and check out our reviews that we have done. We have reviews coming out for Gran Turismo. We have a review coming out for Blue Beetle, and a slew of other things as well. So we'll talk to you guys soon. Like, subscribe, hit the bell button, guys. Thank you. Filing out the top of the world. I can see the skyline. 50-mile radius on my timeline. Ain't nothing on my mind. Oh, no.